Hi, I'm Norman Weilberger, and today we're going to have another look at applications of rational trigonometry to surveying. Our first problem is that of going up a hill. If a hill is too steep, it makes sense to cut across it diagonally. And if you're building a train on a hill, you have to cut it across. So here's our hill, making a spread of S with the horizontal. We're going to cut our train across the hill diagonally like that, making a spread of R to the maximum slope. And we're interested in the spread U that this train consequently makes with the horizontal. So we're interested in establishing the relationship between these three spreads, S, R, and U. We have no quadrants as normalized, so let's assume that this quadrant here between B and C is equal to 1, and this quadrant here from E to D is also equal to 1. Then in this right triangle ABC, the spread S is 1 over the quadrants AC, so the quadrants AC is 1 over S. In the triangle ACE, which is also a right triangle, this spread here, which is 1 minus R, is equal to opposite over hypotenuse quadrants. And so the hypotenuse quadrants QAE is equal to Q of AC divided by 1 minus R. We've just found Q of AC here, and so we get Q of AE equals 1 over S times 1 minus R. And now finally, in this right triangle, ADE, we've just found that quadrants AE, the spread U, which we're after, is 1 over that quadrants we've just found. So U is equal to 1 over Q of AE. Substitute what we just found, we get S times 1 minus R. There's the relationship that we're after, a very simple and elegant relation between U, S, and R. S is the spread of the hill, R is the spread in which we cut across, and U is the consequence, effective spread of the train. Here's an example. If we have a train which can go, say, at a slope of 1/3 in terms of distance, then suppose that the spread of the hill is 30 degrees, or 1/4. Well, in that case, then U will be equal to the spread here, U is 1/10. And so that, if we solve for R, we get R equals 3/5. So that tells us that we have to cut across the hill at a spread of 3/5 if the hill originally has 30 degrees and we want to just go up a slope of 1/3. For our second problem, we'll have a look at a situation where we have a known horizontal triangle formed by three points A1, A2, A3. So this triangle is known and it's horizontal. Above A3, there's a flagpole or something, and we measure the vertical spread to that flagpole at both the point A1 and the point A2. So we measure this spread R1 here and this spread R2 here. And what we're interested in is establishing the relationship between R1 and R2 and the spreads of the original base triangle, S1, S2, and S3. All right, let's start with this right triangle here. H over this equals this over that. So H over Q2 equals R1 over 1 minus R1. Exactly in the same way over here, H over Q1 is now R2 divided by 1 minus R2. So we have two equations, and we're going to divide one of these equations by the other. So we'll just take this equation and divide it by this one. On the left-hand side, we're going to get Q1 divided by Q2. So we're taking this divided by that. And on the right-hand side, we get this quantity divided by this quantity. In other words, this times the reciprocal of this. And now we observe that in the original triangle A1, A2, A3, the spread law again tells us that Q1 over Q2 is equal to S1 over S2. So altogether, we get a single relationship connecting R1 and R2 and S1 and S2. And I'll leave it to you as a little exercise to manipulate that algebraically to show that you can rewrite it in several forms, including this one here. S1 over R1 minus S2 over R2 equals S1 minus S2. There's a relationship between these four quantities that allows us to solve for one of them if we know the other three. Our third problem is a rather famous surveying problem. we're on a railway track, and there's some mountain that we want to determine the height of. And what we're allowed to do is we're allowed to make three separate spread readings, but staying on the railway track. We might imagine that we're in a marsh or something. There's no other place to get to go. So here's our railway track. Here is the mountain top that whose height we want to determine. There's the unknown point that's directly underneath that mountain top. We can't necessarily see that. Okay, and our strategy is to measure the vertical spread of that height, that mountain, at this point A1, call it R1, at this point A2, call it R2, and at some intermediate point D, also on the railway track, call that spread R3. We'll assume we also know this quadrant's P1 and this quadrant's P2. So let's have first a look at this triangle here. This spread R1, opposite over hypotenuse quadrants. So that's H over this quadrant will be H plus Q2 by Pythagoras. So R1 equals H over H plus Q2. And from that we can solve for Q2. Q2 therefore equals 1 minus R1 divided by R1 times H. Exactly in a similar way, using this triangle here, we get the relation that Q1, this quadrant here, is equal to 1 minus R2 over R2 times H. And from the point D, we get that P3, this quadrant here, is 1 minus R3 over R3 times H. Now I'm going to have to invoke a theorem called Stewart's theorem, which is just a theorem about this horizontal triangle A1, A2, A3, and this additional point D. With these quadrants as marked here, Stewart's theorem says the following, that P2 times P3 plus P1 minus Q2 all squared equals P1 times P3 plus P2 minus Q1 all squared. So if we substitute now the three expressions that we've got so far for Q1, Q2, and P3 into this, then we're going to get an expression that only involves P1, P2, our three spreads R1, R2, and R3, and our unknown quantity H. So you substitute these immediately directly in here and you get this following relationship. And it's a quadratic equation in H. There's the unknown H, and all the other quantities are observables. So that's a quadratic equation that you can solve for H. It's very illuminating to try to do this problem using angles and classical trigonometry, highly non-trivial exercise. Okay, of course I can't just leave it like this. I have to explain to you where Stewart's theorem comes from, why this is the correct form for it. That's quite an interesting exercise. This result actually goes back several hundred years. So next time we'll talk about Stewart's theorem. I hope you'll join me for that. I'm Norman Wahlberger. Thanks for listening.